Hi everybody, welcome to Shell Lectures. So in this video we'll be talking about units and measurements, a class 11 NCERT physics topic meant for NEET. So whenever we do a measurement, be it we are measuring the length of a table or we are measuring the mass of an object, whenever we are doing a measurement, it involves comparison with an internationally accepted reference standard called as unit. So we always compare the result that we have written at the end of a measurement with an international standard which is called as the unit. Okay, so the result which we write is always accompanied by a thing which is known as unit. The units are very less in number, though the physical quantities are very large in number. And there are two types of quantities. They are fundamental quantities and derived quantities, as we know earlier. Fundamental quantities are the representative ones or the base quantities from which the derived quantities are derived. So the fundamental quantities have specific units which are known as fundamental units, or they are also known as base units. And the quantities which are derived from fundamental quantities are derived quantities. Example is speed, and they have units which are known as derived units. So both of these fundamental and derived units can be called together as system of units. And then we have an exceptional case. Some physical units can't completely be specified. Even though you specify their magnitude or direction or unit, you can't actually specify them completely. For example, if you have scalar, they are physical quantities with only magnitude. And vectors are physical quantities with both magnitude and direction. But there are some physical quantities which can't be specified at all, even though you specify them by means of magnitude, direction and unit. And they are called by the name tensors. An example for this is moment of inertia. So, we have three systems of units that have originated and are put into use even till this date, and they are CGS, FPS and MKS, and the internationally accepted one, we'll be talking about that in the next slide. But these three, CGS, MKS and FPS, have originated in France and Britain. CGS and MKS have originated in France and FPS has originated in Britain. So these three are also very important systems of units that are being practiced even today. So the numerical value is inversely proportional to the unit. What do we mean by that? For example, if we take 1 kilogram here, kilogram, the unit is of a higher value, whereas the numerical value is just 1. But when you make it into gram, when you convert it into gram, it becomes 1000 grams, which means the numerical value has gone up, whereas the unit has come down. So when the unit is up, then the number is down, and when the number is up, the unit is down, which means numerical value and the unit is inversely proportional to each other. So we need to know about the systems of units that have been adopted so far and that are being put into use even till this date. So three systems are being used. They are CGS, FPS and MKS. CGS is Gaussian system of units and FPS is British system of units. So in these three systems of units, we define the basic units for length, mass and time as centimeter, gram and second for CGS, foot, pound and second for FPS, and meter, kilogram and second for MKS. So these are the base units for length, mass and time respectively in these three systems of units. But the internationally accepted and used system of units is SI system. It's actually rationalized MKS because it's just a slight modification of the MKS system of units. So what is its advantage? It uses decimals. So the conversion between one unit to the other in the SI system is very easy. That's why we opt for SI system during these days. So what is SI? SI is nothing but Systeme Internationale de Units. It's a universally accepted system of units, standard scheme of symbols, units and abbreviations, which was developed and recommended by General Conference on Weights and Measures in 1971 for international usage in scientific, technical, industrial and commercial work. So we have 7 base units according to the SI, along with two other things, which are plane angle and solid angle, about which we'll be dealing with separately in the next few slides. So, when we learn about base units, we also must know about their characteristics. So, base units must be very well defined and they must be invariable. That is, they must be constant and they must be easily accessible, reproducible and convenient to use. So, the 7 base units, as you can see on the screen as per SI, are length, mass, time, electric current, thermodynamic temperature, amount of substance, luminous intensity. And the units which are meant for these base quantities are meter, kilogram, second, ampere, Kelvin, mole, candela respectively. So there is a line which is written beside mole. Let's read that. So when mole is used, we must also specify the elementary entities like 5 moles of atoms. So you must also specify the elementary entities, be it atoms, molecules, ions, electrons or whatever. So all these are the units of these base quantities. Here you can find out that ampere and Kelvin, A and K, have not been capitalized. When you are writing the complete unit, there is no necessity to capitalize the first letter. But when you are writing the symbol for that physical quantity, you must make it as a capital letter. For meter, kilogram, second, mole and candela, we have just used small letters throughout. But for ampere and Kelvin, we have capitalized the first letter because they are the names of scientists. So these are the 7 base units. So then we have to know about plane angle and solid angle. So what is a plane angle and what is a solid angle? Plane angle is nothing but ratio of length of arc to the radius r of the arc. We can learn this by this diagram. So as you can see here, the first thing is plane angle. So it's nothing but ratio of the arc length. As you can see here, the arc is ds. So the arc length is ds divided by the radius of the arc is r, radian, that is the unit. So theta is how we denote plane angle and radius is the unit of plane angle. So theta is equal to ds by r radian, or you can even write it as rad as short form. And then the next figure is solid angle. Solid angle is nothing but ratio of the area intercepted by a spherical surface. As you can see in the figure, it's dA. What I'm talking about is dA. It's the area which is intercepted by the spherical surface, the ratio of the area to the square of the radius of the spherical surface. So the radius is r here, so it must be squared, it will be r square. And the unit is steradian, which can also be written as sr in short form. So the way how we represent solid angle is omega. So let's read it. Solid angle is the ratio of the intercepted area of a spherical surface described about the apex to the square of its radius r. It's denoted by omega and the unit is steradian with the symbol sr. Both of these are ratios and hence they are dimensionless. We'll learn about this in the next few slides. So now we have to know about parallax method, which is a method used to find out the very far away distances. For example, the distance of a planet from the earth. So how do we do that? So what is parallax first of all? Parallax is nothing but when you are having a pencil in front of you and there is a background behind and you are looking at the pencil with your left eye closed, it will look as if it's in a specific position. And when you are closing your right eye and looking at the same pencil or finger, it will look in the other position. So what does this mean? There has been a displacement which has taken place and that's what is known as parallax. And the distance that has occurred is known as basis. So here the basis is the distance between the eyes. So how can we do this parallax method? How can we adopt this parallax method to find the distance of the very far planet from Earth? So we have a figure here. As you can see here, you can see a figure here. So there is a small a distance between A and B. So A and B are the positions from which we are measuring the distance towards the planet. So there is a distance B between A and B. So the angle which is at the top, that is ASB, is known as the parallax angle or parallactic angle, and it's denoted by theta, and it's very 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 small because the planet is very 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 far away from the planet Earth. Okay. So you can see that the distance from the Earth to the planet is denoted by the letter capital D. That is what we are interested to find. So we can take, as theta is very small, we can assume AB as an arc of length B with center as S, the top one, with center at S, and we can take D as the radius. So I repeat, AB as an arc of arc length B and D as the radius and S as the center. So this will absolutely be the plane angle. Theta, parallax angle, will become the plane angle. So I can write theta is equal to ratio between the arc length and the radius. So the arc length is B here and the radius is D here. So B by D. So you can also write it as B is equal to D theta, and from that you can definitely find out D. We can also find out the other thing which is known as angular diameter, from which we can determine the size of the planet by the formula alpha is equal to D by D. So alpha can be measured from the same location. It's nothing but the angle between two diametrically opposite points as we are viewing through the... Okay, now we have to know about estimating very small distances. So we just now learned how to estimate very large distances. So now let's know how to estimate very small distances. So we can use certain instruments like vernier calipers, screw gauge, spirometer, of course. But what we are talking about is very small. So we cannot use even those instruments. Because they can only measure up to an accuracy of 10 power minus 4 and 10 power minus 5, but we require something which is nearly 10 power minus 9. So, when we talk about the astronomical microscope also, it uses visible light to look at the system under investigation. So, an optical microscope, we know that it uses visible light. So, light, you know that it possesses wave-like natures and also particle, but let's talk about wave. It has wave-like features. So, the resolution to which an optical microscope can go actually is the wavelength of light, because light is a wave. Light is a wave. So, the wavelength of light is going to be the resolution to which an optical microscope can be used. So, we know that for visible light, the range of wavelengths is from 4000 Armstrong to 7000 Armstrong. And beyond this, or smaller than this, this optical microscope cannot resolve any sizes. So, this is also of not much use. Talking about electron beams, they can also be focused by electric and magnetic fields. Its resolution is also limited because electron is also a wave, according to the Davison-Germer experiment. So, electron is also a wave, so it's also limited finally. So, as wavelength of electron is very, 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 very small, it's equal to an angstrom. So, you can easily make electron microscopes of 0.6 Armstrong resolution. So, they can resolve atoms and molecules in a material, because we were talking about only 10 power minus 9, but Armstrong is 10 power minus 10. But nowadays, electron beams and tunneling microscopy have been developed in which the limit of resolution is very better than Armstrong's also. In tunneling microscopy, the limit of resolution is much better than Armstrong's. So, how can we determine the molecular size of oleic acid? That's what we are going to learn in this slide. So, what is oleic acid first of all? It's a soapy liquid with the molecular size of approximately 10 power minus 9 meters. So, first of all, what do? We just take a single layer of oleic acid on water surface. So, we are taking a single layer of oleic acid on water surface. So, now what we are doing is, we are taking 1 centimeter cube of oleic acid and we are putting it into alcohol and making a 20 centimeter cube solution. From this 20 centimeter cube solution, we are taking again 1 centimeter cube solution and diluting it to 20 centimeter cube again. So, now what is the concentration of the oleic acid in the final solution? It's going to be 1 by 20 into 20, because we took 1 centimeter cube of oleic acid and it was diluted twice. So, 1 by 20 into 20 is the concentration of oleic acid right now. So, now what else do? We sprinkle the lycopodium powder on the water surface in a large trough. So, we are just sprinkling the lycopodium powder on a water surface. And what we are doing is, we are taking the solution which we had, 1 by 20 into 20 part of oleic acid, that solution, we are taking just one drop and you are dropping it onto that water which contains a lycopodium powder. So, when you do that, the oleic acid starts spreading as a circular film and it also develops a molecular thickness. And that's what we are interested to find. So, from this, immediately you have to calculate the diameter of the circular film so that you can immediately get on with the area of the film. Okay, immediately you can get on with the area of the film. Now we also have to know volume. With area alone we can't do anything, so we also need volume. So what we do is, we dropped let us assume that we dropped n drops into the water, n drops of solution into the water. So, 1 drop's volume, let it be V. So, n drop's volume, it's going to be NV, right? So, NV centimeter cube is the volume. So, now let's calculate the amount of oleic acid in the solution. That is, already we know that it's 1 by 20 into 20 is the concentration. So, volume, when you are multiplying it with concentration, you will be getting the amount of oleic acid that's present. So, it will be around NV into 1 by 20 into 20 centimeter cube. So, this is going to be the volume and that is going to be the area. So, what happens? You can find the thickness. That's what we are interested in. So, what is the formula for thickness? Thickness formula is volume of the film by area of the film. You know the volume of the film now and you also know the area of the film. So, you can just find the ratio between both of them and then you'll be getting the thickness. That is what is the size of the molecule of oleic acid. And it turns out to be nearly 10 power minus 9 meters. So, what are the range of quantities? As far as length is concerned, it's from 10 power minus 14 meter, very, 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 very small, the size of a proton, to 10 power 26 meters, which is the extent of the observable universe. Talking about mass, it's 10 power minus 30 kilograms. That is very, 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 very light mass of an electron to 10 power 55 kilograms, which is the mass of the observable unknown universe. Talking about time, it's from 10 power minus 24 seconds. That is the lifespan of the most unstable particle to 10 power 17. That is the age of the universe. Okay. So everything is universe. The highest of everything is universe. Length, mass and time. The lowest alone differs. So how do we measure length? What are the instruments that we use to measure length? And what are the quantities that we write? Now what are the supplementary quantities that that we can use to denote length? So we all know that we use meter scale to measure length. That is the range that we can measure using meter scale is 10 power minus 3 to 10 square meter. And talking about vernier calipers, you can measure up to an accuracy of 10 power minus 4. And with spirometer and screw gauge, you can even do it till 10 power minus 5. And very large distances, as we discussed right now, are measured by parallax method. And one Fermi, it's equal to 10 power minus 15 meters. One angstrom is equal to 10 power minus 10 meters. One astronomical unit, AU is astronomical unit. So we must know what an astronomical unit is. An astronomical unit is the distance of sun from earth. So the value turns out to be 1.496 into 10 to the power 11 meters. And we also have light year, which means the distance traveled by light in 1 year with the velocity of light 3 into 10 power 8 meter per second. So it also turns out to be 9.46 into 10 to the power 15 meters. Now talking about parsec, parsec is nothing but distance at which the average radius of the Earth's orbit subtends an angle of 1 arc second. So that value is 3.08 into 10 to the power 16 meters. So these are the values of length and the instruments which we use to measure length. So how do we measure mass? So first of all, we must know about mass. Mass is actually independent of temperature, pressure or an object's location or whatever. And the SI unit of mass is kilogram. But for atoms and molecules, you can't measure things, the elementary entities with, the SI unit as kilogram. So we have a special unit for that, which is known as unified atomic mass, which was earlier known as atomic mass unit AMU, which has now been, altered as U. So what is 1U? What is the value of 1U? That's nothing but 1 by 12th of mass of an atom of carbon 12, including the mass of electrons. So that is 1 12th of the mass of an atom of carbon 12. Also, you must include the mass of electrons. So the value turns out to be 1.66 into 10 to the power minus 27 grams, and this value is important. So mass of very commonly available objects, as you can see in the grocery store and jewelry shop, are determined by a common balance. And very large masses are measured by gravitational method, which is based on the Newton's law of gravitation. Very small masses are measured by mass spectrograph, and the unit is unified atomic mass, and they are measured by mass spectrograph. So what is the principle behind that mass spectrograph is given in that bracket. This, the radius of the trajectory is proportional to the mass of the charged particle moving in a uniform magnetic and electric field. So when a charged particle is moving in a uniform magnetic and electric field, it will experience a trajectory whose radius is directly proportional to the mass that the charged particle carries. Then we have to know about the measurement of time. How do we measure time? So the atomic standard of time is the basis of the cesium clocks, which are also known as the atomic clocks. So this is completely based on the vibrations which are produced in cesium atom. How are the vibrations produced? Look at the third point. Vibration is due to the transition between two levels. Two levels of the ground state. They are the two hyperfine levels of the ground state of the cesium atom. Due to that transition which is taking place, the vibration is being produced, and that vibration regulates the rate of cesium clock. In the cesium clock, 1 second is actually the time needed for 919-263-1770 vibrations of the radiation. So these many vibrations must take place so that 1 second is complete in a cesium clock. It's very, very accurate. That is, 1 part in 10 part 13 is what is uncertain as per these atomic clocks. They can barely gain or lose just 3 microseconds per year. So the cesium atomic clock in India is maintained by National Physics Laboratory, which is at Delhi, and it maintains the Indian standard of time. So NPL is completely responsible for all the maintenance and improvement of physical standards like time and frequency in India. So these cesium clocks are highly effective and accurate, and they are used for measuring time. So the national standard of second and frequency is also maintained by 4 cesium clocks, which are placed at NPL as far as India is concerned. Wow, 10 power 41 is an amazing number. So what's special behind this 10 power 41? Let's look at it. So The ratio of the longest and shortest length that has been calculated turns out to be 10 power 41. Okay, fine. And the ratio of the longest and shortest time intervals is also 10 power 41. So that's a mere coincidence, you know, that they are very large numbers, but still their ratio turns out to be the same. And the ratio of the largest and smallest masses is not 10 power 41, but it's square, that is 10 power 82. So this is merely a coincidence that has taken place. 10 power 41 is a magic. So what is an error? Error is nothing but an uncertainty in measurement. All measurements contain error. So what is the difference between accuracy and precision? What is actually the main difference between these two terms? For example, we are taking a measurement and we have the true value or the mean value as 3.5 is the mean value. Okay, 3.5 is the mean value for a measurement which you are undertaking. And you are getting the measurements as 3.2. One student, A student, gets it as 3.2 with an instrument whose least count is 0.1. And the other is getting the answer as 3.4 with precision 0.01. Okay, so the A student is doing it with 3.2 with 0.1 least count, and the second one is doing with 3.4 and 0.01 least count. So what is precision? It tells us to what limit of resolution the quantity is measured. That is, it tells us about the least count. So the very well precise measurement tells us that the least count is very, very perfect, right? So the second person who measured it is the measurement is more precise because his least count was 0.01. So what about accuracy? Accuracy is nothing but the measure of how close the value which you have measured is to the true value. That is the, you know, the closeness, the degree of closeness between the value which we have measured and the true value is known as accuracy. Talking about the first person who got 3.2, but the mean value is 3.5, it's a little bit far away. But the second one, 3.4 and 3.5, just 0.1 difference. So his measurement is more accurate and it's more precise also. So what are the types of errors? Systematic errors and random errors. Systematic errors are nothing but they might either be positive or they might be negative. So they are always unidirectional. So they might be due to the instrumental errors. That is, the errors in the instrument may be due to the calibration of the imperfect arrangement and calibration of the instrument. Zero error. So where the vernier caliper zero has to coincide with the main scale, but it's not coinciding. And the meter scale, one part is just worn off. Or the temperature graduations, it must be 100 degrees Celsius for boiling point of water, but it's 104 degrees Celsius. All these come under instrumental errors. Talking about experimental procedure. Whenever we place a thermometer under the armpit, as the temperature is definitely going to be lower than the actual body temperature, because the external factors like change in temperature, humidity and the wind velocity all come into the fray. So that thing, the experimental procedure, can also bring about systematic errors. And personal errors are due to the individual who is undertaking the measurement is careless or ignorant or his own bias. That's what is known as personal errors. And very good example is parallax errors. So how can these errors be reduced? They can be reduced by improving the experimental techniques, and we have to select good instruments which have no zero error and which have good precision and accuracy and all that. And also we must remove the personal bias. That is, people who are undertaking the measurement must be very vigilant and careful about what they are doing. So also we can estimate the errors at last after doing a measurement or after completing an experiment. You can just estimate the errors and write it down, and you can do some calculations to get it right. For positive error we have a formula, and for negative error we have formula. With that we can change the errors. For negative error we have to make it positive, for positive we have to make it negative. So what are the types of the other types of errors? Are random errors. As the name says, it's very irregular. So it's due to the fluctuations in the experimental conditions. And also personal unbiased errors. For example, a person takes a measurement for the first time and he gets it as 3.2, and the next time he does the same, he gets it as 3.3. So these kind of things are known as random errors. A very good example for random error is least count error. So we know what is least count. Least count is nothing but the smallest value that an instrument can measure. So it's a type of random error, and the error which is associated with the least count or the limit of resolution of the instrument, which is known as least count error. For vernier, it's 0.01 centimeters, and for spirometer and screw gauge, it's 0.001 centimeters. So how can we avoid this least count error? We can avoid this by using instruments of good precision, and we must improve the experimental procedures, and also the person who is undertaking the measurement must be very careful and vigilant about what he is doing. And a very good choice for removing least count error is repeating the observations again and again for 5 or 6 times and then taking the arithmetic mean of all of them, so that you will be getting a very exact and nearer value to the true value instead of just taking 2 values and taking a mean. If you are taking 6, it will be more accurate. So what are the other types of errors? They are absolute error. Absolute error is nothing but the difference between the individual measurement that you are taking, for example, a particular, the second time you are taking that measurement minus the true value or the mean value will be giving you the absolute error, which is denoted by delta A. And it turns out to be positive or negative, but mod delta A, modulus delta A will always be positive. Okay. So the arithmetic mean, if we take for example, we have 4 or 5 absolute errors and we are taking arithmetic mean of all of them, then the answer which we derive is known as the mean absolute error, which is denoted by delta A mean, as you can see in the second point. So any measurement that we take, for example, let's take an example as A. I'm taking the measurement of a physical quantity A. So it's going to lie between A mean minus delta A mean and A mean plus delta A mean. So this is what the range that the measurement which we take lies between. So we also have relative error, which is the ratio of the mean absolute error to the mean value. That's also known as fractional error. And when you multiply it by 100 and take percent of it, it's known as percentage error. So these are also very important types of errors. So what is the least count? Least count, as I told you earlier, is the smallest value that an instrument can measure. So if we take the size of one main scale division as M units and one vernier scale division as V units, the least count at vernier is given by M minus V. So M minus V is the vernier constant and LC is the least count of vernier calipers. That is 1 MSD minus 1 VSD. The main scale division's value minus vernier scale's division value will give you the least count of vernier. For a screw gauge or spirometer, the least count will be pitch by number of divisions on the circular scale. So that's what is the formula for screw gauge or spirometer. And what's the formula for pitch? It's the distance moved by the screw on the linear scale by the number of full rotations given. So when the least count goes on decreasing, accuracy goes on increasing and error goes on decreasing. So least count must decrease. Okay. Only then accuracy can increase and error decreases, so that we can have a productive measurement. So what are the combination of errors? We have 2 errors. For example, in a particular measurement, we have plus or minus 0.02 and in the other we have plus or minus 0.04. So when 2 quantities are added or subtracted, the absolute error is the sum of the absolute errors in the individual quantities. So just adding both of them, you'll be getting 0.06. And the same thing goes for multiplication and division. Whatever you're doing, you can multiply the numerical value which you have got, but you should not multiply the error. For example, you are having 8 plus or minus 2 and 6 plus or minus 4. So when you multiply both of these, it will be 48 plus or minus 6. You are not going to multiply 2 and 4 here. You can just add both of them. And rule 3 is the relative error in a physical quantity raised to the power k. When some physical quantity is raised to power k, it's k times the relative error in the individual quantity. So in the individual quantity, how much relative error is there into the power to which the physical quantity is raised will give you the relative error in a physical quantity which is raised to the power k. So we need to know about significant figures now. So what is significant figure? So whenever we take a measurement, we always know that the result contains certain digits plus the uncertain digit. For example, if we take the period of oscillation as 1.62 seconds, here 1 is definite, 6 is also reliable, but 2 is not reliable. It's uncertain. It may be 1.63 when you take the experiment again, or 1.64 when you do the measurement again. So all these figures are known as significant figures. So the use is that it indicates precision, and the precision depends on least count. So only because you are changing the units, it does not change the number of significant figures. For example, let's take it as 2.308 centimeters. Here you can see 1, 2, 3, 4 significant figures are there. And when you are changing it into meter or when you are changing it into millimeter, everywhere the number of significant figures stays the same. And then we have to know about the rules of significant figures. All the non-zero digits are significant. All digits which are non-zero are significant. The problem only comes with zero. And the zeros between 2 non-zero digits are significant. Okay, fine. Even the previous example, 2.308. 0 is between 3 and 8. So it's significant. Okay. But the zeros which appear at the start they are not significant. That we'll learn in the next slide. So the numbers which are neither rounded, they are not rounded and they are not representing measured values. For example, let's take radius. Radius, what's the formula for radius? Radius is equal to diameter by 2. So we have very exact number 2. It's not rounded and it does not represent any measured value. It's just a constant. Okay. It may have infinite number of significant figures, like we can have it as 2.00, 2.000, 2.0000. It might have infinite number of significant figures. So these are very important rules of significant figures. If the number is less than 1, as you can see three on the third line, 0.002308, it's less than 1. So the zeros on the right of the decimal, but to the left of the first non-zero digit. So here the first non-zero digit is 2. So right of the decimal, but to the left of the first non-zero digit. As you can see here, 2 is the non-zero digit. So there are 3 zeros here. And there are 4 significant figures. You must leave these 3 zeros because they are coming at the beginning. Okay. So they are insignificant. Also, the trailing zeros without a decimal point are insignificant. As you can see here, 12,300, there is no decimal point anywhere. So these 2 zeros are going to be insignificant and they have only 3 significant figures. But if it is having a decimal point, then it is significant. As you can see here, there is a decimal point here, so it's going to be 4 significant figures. If there is no decimal point, then these 2 zeros should not be considered. So to remove such ambiguities which are related to the determination, we have to report the number in scientific notation. So what is scientific notation? We must denote it like this, A into 10 power B. So here, what is A? A is the number between 1 to 10 and B is the order of magnitude. B is the order of magnitude which might either be positive or negative. So when you write numbers like 2 into 10 power 5. So what is the number of significant figures in this? 2 into 10 power 5. You must take into account only this 2. You need not worry about the 10 power thing. You need to worry only about this 2. So the power of 10 is very irrelevant to determine the number of significant figures. Then the arithmetic operations. So when we do multiplication or division, this is very, 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 very important. When we do multiplication or division of two numbers, the final result should retain as many significant figures. Okay, so as there are in the original number with the least significant figures. For example, we have a number with 3 significant figures and the other is with 2 significant figures. When you are multiplying, then you must round off the answer to 2 significant figures. And when you are dividing also, the same process goes. But when you are adding or subtracting, the final result should retain as many decimal places as there in the number with the least decimal places. For example, you are having a number with 5 decimal places and the other with 3 decimal places. So when you are adding them up, the answer should contain only 3 decimal places. And when you are subtracting them up, it also should contain 3 decimal places. This is very important. So talking about rounding off next. So what is rounding off? Rounding off is just estimating or rounding the number up to the very nearer number. So the preceding digit is raised by 1 if the insignificant digit is more than 5. For example, you can see this number 2.76. So here the insignificant digit is 6, right? So it's more than 5, right? 6 is more than 5. So what you must do? You must raise the previous number. So when you are removing this, then this becomes 8. Okay, you must raise that number by 1. When the number is 5, so there comes a confusion. The preceding digit is even, then it simply dropped. For example, 2.65. So here the insignificant digit is itself 5 and the number which is preceding that is even. So you can just drop this insignificant figure. But if this is an odd number, like 7 and the insignificant figure is again 5, then this digit is raised by 1. So when you remove this, you must make it as 8. Okay, so if it's 5 and the preceding number is even, you can just drop it, or if it's odd, you have to raise it by 1. So here 2.9979, this is the speed of light, so it is rounded off to 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second, so that it makes the process of computation. So rules to determine the errors. So the relative error that we have for a particular value does not only depend on n, but it also depends on the number itself. For example, when we take a number like 1.02, which has an error of 0.01. So we told that the relative error, which is 0.01 here, does not depend only on n but also on the number itself. So when you want to find the percentage error in that, you can just put it as 0.01 divided by the original value 1.02 into 100, which turned out to be plus or minus 1%. And the next point is very important. Intermediate results in a multi-step computation should be calculated to one more significant figure in every measurement than the number of digits in the least precise measurement. So that line might sound ambiguous, but when we read the example, we can get a clear idea. So the example, the reciprocal of 9.58. So when you are calculating the reciprocal of 9.58, obviously our mind would go to the fact that we have to calculate it only to three significant figures. And we did it so. We calculated to three significant figures. The first zero there is insignificant. So 104 alone will count. So we have three significant figures. So when you do a reciprocal of 0.104, again you should get 9.58, right? But when you are doing that, it turns out to be 9.62. But while you are taking the reciprocal of 9.58 and rounding off it to four significant figures, that is, you are increasing the number of significant figures by one, then it turns out to be 0.1044. And then when you are taking the reciprocal of this number, it's 9.58 again. So what should we do? We have to increase the number of significant figures in the intermediate results so that the measurement is very accurate and proper. Then we have to know about dimensions. So the base units, the seven base units are the seven dimensions of the physical world. So they are length, mass, time, current, temperature, amount of substance and luminous intensity. So whenever we put that bracket in physics, it denotes dimensional analysis. So you can put capital L for length, capital M for mass, capital T for time, capital A for current because it's ampere, capital K for temperature because it's Kelvin, and MOL, small letters for mole, amount of substance, and candela, CD for luminous intensity. So these are all the basic dimensions of base quantities, and with this we can derive the dimensional formula of all the derived quantities. For example, the volume, as you can see, a dimension of volume. So what is volume basically? It's length into breadth into height, and all of them are basically distances. All of them are basically lengths, right? So L into L into L will give you L cube. That's it. And talking about force, force is mass into acceleration. So mass is going to be M. Acceleration is meter second power minus 2, right? The unit is meter second power minus 2. So when you write it down, you can write L for meter, T for S, so LT power minus 2, and when you combine them, it becomes MLT power minus 2. So these two are the dimensions of volume and force. They both are derived quantities. They have been derived from the base units. So an equation which is obtained by equating a physical quantity, like we have taken force here and we have equated with its dimensional formula, this is known as dimensional equation. So what are the applications of this dimensional analysis? So only those quantities which have the same dimensions can be added or subtracted based on the principle of homogeneity. So what does the principle of homogeneity say? Only those physical quantities which have the same dimensions, they must have, if it's MLT power minus 2, for one quantity, it can be added to another quantity which has the same dimension as MLT power minus 2. And also with dimensional analysis, we can deduce many relations. If we know the physical quantities and the dependence between those physical quantities, we can derive many relations. And we can also check the correctness of equations. For example, they'll give you an expression and ask you to find if they are right. If both LHS and RHS have the same dimensions, then they are going to be right. So we can also check the accuracy and homogeneity of expressions. And the physical quantities represented by symbols on both sides. And equal to zero on both sides, the homogeneity must be followed. That is, they must have the same dimensions. So also we can convert a physical quantity from one system of units to the other by using dimensional analysis. So what are the drawbacks? Anything which has advantage will also have a disadvantage. So drawbacks, trigonometric, logarithmic and exponential functions are dimensionless. They do not have any dimensions. Ratio, as we talked earlier, for plane angle and solid angle, I told you that there are no dimensions. So why? Because they are ratios. So the ratios don't have any dimensions, and the refractive index even. It's speed of light in vacuum by speed of light in the medium, and it also has no dimensions. In mechanics, the formula depends upon more than three physical quantities, but we know only about ML and T. So there also it becomes a problem. If dimensions are given, the physical quantity may not be unique because several physical quantities have the same dimension. So just by giving the dimension, you cannot arrive at a particular physical quantity. But just by giving a physical quantity, you can arrive at a dimensional formula. And it also does not give any information about the scalar and vector nature of the physical quantity. You cannot just guess by seeing the dimensional formula whether a physical quantity is scalar or vector. And I told you that LHS and RHS must be of same dimensions. But if they have the same dimensions, they are not going to be very exact or very correct. But if they are going to be wrong, definitely the equation is not right. But if they are right, they are not completely right. Okay? So how do we convert a physical quantity from one system to the other? By dimensions. That's what it's given here. So magnitude remains the same. Whatever the system you are using, the magnitude remains the same. So for example, if we have a quantity which is expressed as m par a, l par b and t par c. So that is in N1 system. So when you are putting it into N2, so you can use this formula. N2 is equal to N1 into U1 by U2. 1 comes up. So N1 into M1 by M2 power a, L1 by L2 power b, T1 by T2 power c. With this you can convert, for example, from SI system to CGS or SI system to MKS. All that you can do here. So how do we check the homogeneity of equations? As I told you earlier, how do we check the homogeneity of equations? That's what we are going to discuss here. So we have a relation S is equal to UT plus half AT square, and we are going to check its homogeneity. So we must get the same dimensions on both LHS and RHS. So LHS it's S and RHS it's UT plus half AT square. So the dimension for S can be written as its mere distance. So you can write L par 1, that's it. The remaining all will be having zeros. So L par 1. RHS it's UT plus half AT square. You can remove this half. So U, what is U? Velocity. Velocity is meter per second. So it's going to be L T par minus 1. As you can see here, it's L par 1, T par minus 1. T is time. So just, it's being written as time T plus A T square. That is L T par minus 2 into T square. Okay. So when you do this, you will be getting again L1 M par 0 T par 0, which is equal to LHS. So LHS is equal to RHS, so the given equation is dimensionally correct. It's homogeneous. Okay. So how do we deduce the relation between various quantities using the dimensional formula? So first of all, for this to happen, we need to know the dependence. That is, what all the physical quantities depend on what all the other physical quantities. For example, when we are deriving the time period of pendulum, the formula is T is equal to 2 pi into root of L by G. So how do we derive that? First of all, we must know that the time period depends on quantities like length of the wire and acceleration due to gravity and mass of the bob. All these things are being depended upon by the time period of pendulum. So you can write T is equal to K into L par X, G par Y, M par Z. And there K is a dimensionless constant. So when you write the dimensions, T is merely time period. So it's going to be M0, L also 0, T1 because it's time period. Talking about length, it's just distance, merely distance. So L par 1 into X, G is acceleration due to gravity. So acceleration. So L T par minus 2, the power Y. And M is mass, so M alone, M par 1 into Z. So when you are comparing, that is when you are putting L terms together, L par X plus Y you have, and M you have only one Z, and T power to power multiply, so T power minus 2Y. So when you are comparing the, equating and comparing the powers, you can find out here that L here 0, here X plus Y. So X plus Y is equal to 0. Talking about M, here it's Z, there is 0. So Z is equal to 0. So from that you can calculate Y, minus 2Y is equal to 1. So X is equal to 1 by 2, Y is equal to minus 1 by 2 and Z is equal to 0. From that you can write Z is equal to 0. So we don't have mass in the final formula. We have length. Length is raised to the power 1 by 2 and G is raised to the power minus 1 by 2. So in root, L will be at the top and G will be at the bottom. So T is equal to K into root of L by G. Actually, due the experimental observations, based on experimental observations, value of K is 2 pi. So instead of K, you can substitute 2 pi. So the final formula comes out to be T is equal to 2 pi into root of L by G. So from this, you would have come to know that using dimensional analysis, we can check the homogeneity of equations and we can deduce relation between physical quantities, and we can also convert a physical quantity from one system to the other by dimensions. That's it. Thank you so much for watching. Subscribe to my channel if you have not done so far. Like and share this video to whomever you know. Meet you soon with a lot of other lectures on many other chapters. Thank you.